One, MCA is currently accepting applications for the Fredis Bailey Scholarship for International Travel. Any undergraduate student engaging in a collaborative project with a global partner who needs to travel for that project is eligible to apply. Applications are due October 2nd, and additional information is again available at our welcome table. We'd also like to invite all students to join us for the Organizing Change Student Leadership Retreat, which is a program that both of our offices do with other campus partners. That happens October 7th to 8th over at Lake Williamson Retreat Center. It's free and open to students, and if you're interested in learning more about that, you can talk to either myself or Ross, who's getting out more chairs, because we're so glad there's so many of you here today. I promise I'm almost done. Finally, I encourage you to take a look at the series brochures on your seats for the complete series schedule. Please note that any time there's a collaboration between Conversation Cafe and Friday Forum, you're offering free lunch. On the days that we do not have free lunch, you can always buy lunch from the Wise High Pantry, which is delicious. Next week is one of our collaboration ones, so if you come back next week for neighborhood approaches to environmental justice, there will be free lunch that week as well. And with that, it is finally my pleasure to introduce today's speaker. David Ulrich is the Executive Director of the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative. His responsibilities include working with U.S. and Canadian mayors from across the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Basin to advance the protection and restoration of the resource. The initiative leads many efforts to accelerate the work to become a more sustainable region by integrating the environmental, economic, and social activities to improve the quality of life and well-being of its people. Prior to assuming his current position, he served for 30 years as the U.S. EPA's Great Lakes Regional Office in Chicago, working on environmental issues in six states of the upper Midwest. He's worked in many capacities over the years, including Acting Regional Administrator, Deputy Regional Administrator, Waste Management Division Director, Deputy Regional Counsel, Air Enforcement Chief, and Water Enforcement Attorney. For 6 years, he was the U.S. Chair of the Water Quality Board for the International Joint Commission and was a founding member and chair of the Midwest National Resources Group. He was reappointed in 2014 as Chair of the Water Quality Board, serves as Chair of the Great Lakes Advisory Board, and in 2006 was appointed by the President to the Great Lakes Fishery Commission, where he serves as U.S. Session Chair. In 1986, he completed a six-month executive exchange assignment for the German Interior Ministry. The U.S. EPA recognized him for a number of accomplishments during his public service career. Mr. Ulrich graduated from Dartmouth College in 1970 with a degree in English and received his law degree from the University of Wisconsin Law School in 1973. With an emphasis in environmental law. Please join me in welcoming David Holder.
Thank you very much, Casey. Even though I have been out giving talks like this for about 44 years now, I am always astounded that people will actually show up to listen to me. So thank you. Thank you for being here. It's a beautiful day when you could be getting a moment to start on the weekend. And the fact that you're here is deeply appreciated by me. I jumped at the chance to come down here for a lot of reasons, one of which my good friends, Lan and Pam Rickard, who are very active in a number of social justice and environmental issues down here, asked me if I would. And they're good people, so I said yes. Secondly, our son was a graduate of the University of Illinois, so I have a lot of fond feelings. And thirdly, my late wife and I had a lot of good experiences with the Y over the years, particularly a camp up in northern Wisconsin that Lan and Pam may know about, Camp Manitouish, that really taught a lot about personal character development, provided opportunities for women to do kind of team building and physical exertion activities well before those opportunities were available in other places. So I come here with all good feelings. One little correction. As of July 1st, I am no longer the executive director of the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative. I am an advisor. I was going to be a senior advisor, but I don't want to be senior, so I'm just an advisor to the organization. I have moved into something roughly described as semi-retirement, and in talking with Professor Clark Bullard, emeritus. Are you emeritus? Yeah. He's 60 to 80 hours a week of still working. I am hoping to do less than that. But when you get into this work related to protecting this planet that we are, you know, so fortunate to have, and issues related to social justice that are directly related to it, it's really hard to stop because it's so important and it's so rewarding to be engaged in it. And I anticipate continuing for some long period of time being actively engaged. Unless anyone has an objection, and I would hope they don't, I'm going to take my sport coat off because it is I just want to stay a little cooler. I'm an anachronism. I read a hard copy newspaper. I used to wear a coat and tie to work every day and all of that good stuff. So I thought, in respect to all of you, I would wear a coat and tie today. The coat needs to go right now. But I do want to show off my tie just a little bit. You like that? It's designed by the Aboriginal people in Australia. And just recently I had an opportunity. I spent 3 weeks in northeastern Australia just off the Great Barrier Reef and had an opportunity to get a chance to see the Great Barrier Reef. Has anyone in here had an opportunity to see the Great Barrier Reef? Good, one person in place. I don't know about you. I've seen a lot of the world, and I've seen a lot of beautiful things. But when I put my goggles and snorkel on and look underwater at the fish and the coral, I think I was seeing maybe the most beautiful natural feature of the planet that I have ever seen. It was literally overwhelming, and we were out there for a day and did 3 hours, separate hours of dives. And the fact that it is threatened, like many other of our resources, by climate change, and I will say there is climate change, and I know it's okay to say that in Champaign, Urbana, because this was one of the first places where the scientists and Professor Wobbles, among others, started to raise concerns about it. But the fact that this and so many other of our treasured resources are being threatened, and with storms like we've experienced, and as with most things, people who are much more disadvantaged than we are always suffer the brunt of these things more than we do. If we do not apply every ounce of energy we have to dealing with that problem, shame on us. We really, really need to step up to the plate, not only for people today, but for all future generations. I cannot imagine there not being a Great Barrier Reef, or it becomes a pretty good barrier reef. But we don't have the Great Lakes. We become pretty good lakes. It would be an absolute tragedy. So as usual, I just rambled on a little bit before I got to my point, but thank you for your tolerance in that. I've got a long-standing relationship with water, as we all do. I don't remember the first part of it quite as well because I was still in my mother's womb at the time. But that is, you know, where we have our first experience with water. And we all know that our bodies are about 70% water. So if we don't really understand and appreciate the deep relationship that we have with water, I think we're really missing the boat, to shift the metaphor just a little bit. But unfortunately, particularly in this part of the country, where we have had an abundance of water for such a long time, it is something that we can easily take for granted. I grew up in Wausau, Wisconsin, on the Wisconsin River, and we were proudly taught it was the hardest working river in the United States or the world. I don't know if that was true or not, but it was kind of a statement that the pulp and paper mills had basically harnessed the river to their benefit in terms of the flows and generating hydropower and dumping their waste, that made it a hard-working river. Well, as with most communities, everyone turned their backs to the river because it was a conveyance of pollution, and it was working hard doing other things other than being a resource with which we could interact as humans. So fortunately, I grew up in a family where we had the resources to drive 100 miles north to the inland lakes that hadn't been contaminated quite so badly. And Land and Pam know where that is, up in northern Wisconsin, Boulder Junction, Land O'Lakes, Presque Isle. I don't know if any of you know that. But that is where I started to really interact with the inland lakes and appreciate the real water experience that can be enjoyed. Later in life, after moving to Chicago, the Great Lakes became an entirely new experience for me. But again, kind of another just wonder that much surface fresh water can be collected in one place and essentially is available to us. But unfortunately, all of these water resources have been horribly abused, have been taken for granted in the past. I will make another confession at this point. I am an eternal, incurable optimist. I think we have made tremendous progress on protecting our water over the last 50 years. I think it may well be threatened as much or more now than it was before, but that does not take away from the fact that great progress has been made. We need to keep in mind that well over a billion people do not have sufficient drinking water on a day-to-day basis. Over 2 billion people do not have adequate water for all their domestic purposes. That's a lot of people, not that many in the U.S., but we do have experiences like Flint, Michigan, occurring last year and the year before, Toledo, Ohio, and it's not an accident that these things happen in the Flints and Toledos as well, where we have let down our guard, and I could spend hours talking about all of the nuances of that, but the fact is, happened, and in 21st century United States developed areas, people were being poisoned by the water that they were drinking. Or in the Toledo situation, they had to drive many, many miles just to get adequate drinking water and water for domestic purposes. So it is a real serious problem globally, and we have pockets of it here, and again, unfortunately, in low-income and disadvantaged communities. We would do well to listen to the indigenous peoples in this, on this planet, and particularly in this part of the planet, where water has always been treated as kind of a very sacred part. And women in indigenous communities were the keepers of the water, and I think that was a good thing. You may have heard about the water walkers. You might just Google that. It's a group of indigenous women, older women, who have been, over the last 5 or 6 years, doing walks around the Great Lakes, symbolically protecting them. And it's been a very inspirational thing, and we could do much to learn more from that approach. So, shifting gears a little bit at this point to the kind of progress that has been made, I want to talk a little bit about the things I was fortunate enough to participate in. Right out of law school, I graduated on a Saturday afternoon, and Monday morning I was working as an enforcement attorney for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, and the Clean Water Act had been passed and came into law in October of 1972, and this was May of 1973 when I started working on water pollution issues. Interestingly enough, the first matters I was assigned to were on the Wisconsin River, where I had grown up. There were 17 pulp and paper mills up and down the river, which had been subjected to very minimal control requirements over the years. The Clean Water Act was really a game changer, but it is important to understand the context within which that happened. Although I'll keep the focus on water, there was a lot of other stuff going on, and there are a few other people in the room with grayer hair or less hair, and who remember the late 60s, and there was a lot going on. It was civil rights, including the rights of women and indigenous people. It was the anti-war movement, because the Vietnam War was in full swing at that time. And it was the environmental movement. And this created a climate for what I think has led to some very dramatic and positive social change over the last 50-year period. Although it's obvious that we still have a long ways to go, it is important to know that we have made progress. Barack Obama was president for 8 years, and I can't tell you how kind of flattering it is that, to know that I guess he was the speaker at one of these, along with Senator Russ Feingold of Wisconsin, a gentleman I know, and Angela Davis as well. So that is a real honor, and we have made progress, but painfully, we have a long ways to go. There were predecessors to the Clean Water Act, and interestingly enough, there was a little recognized and little known law known as the 1899 Refuse Act, which some very creative environmentalists and a congressman, Henry Royce from Wisconsin, pulled out of the cobwebs in the closet. And basically, there was a law that said you couldn't dump anything into the water without a RAP permit, Refuse Act Permit Program permit. Nobody had any permits. Everybody just totally ignored it. But that was a kind of a foundation that led to the Clean Water Act and enabled, ultimately, there to be tremendous controls on water. The other thing that was critically important, the Clean Air Act passed in 1970, total game changer with regard to air pollution, particularly in urban areas, but other areas as well. And also something that a lot of people forget, and it was way beyond symbolic, was the passage of the National Environmental Policy Act, NEPA, which included the famous environmental impact statements that drove industry and government nuts. But basically what Congress said, if you are going to do any major action that has significant implications for the environment, you got to think twice about it and look at how you can minimize the impact on the environment. So it wasn't just the Clean Water Act that was coming into place, but all of these other things were going on as well. I'm going to talk today mostly about surface water. We need to understand that groundwater is exceedingly important as well. It's a whole different ballgame in terms of dealing with groundwater. Much less federal involvement in it. It's much more a matter of state and local control. But it's another one of these out of sight, out of mind things that people say, oh, you know, you just dig a hole and you pump and, you know, you get water. Just as a little recent experience and example associated with it, that I was out on a ranch near Goondiwindi, Australia, and getting a tour of the ranch by the 90-year-old man who still runs the 5,000 acres, and we came to the pump, and they said, well, now, how deep does that go down? It's called, referred to as a bore, not a well. And he says, I think it's about 4,800 feet that they go to get water. Well, up in northern Wisconsin, I know we went down 40 feet. Probably have to go a little deeper around here. But groundwater is an equally precious resource that we have to take into account. One of the other interesting dynamics in dealing with water, particularly on the Great Lakes, and also with some of the other waters like the Colorado River, it's not just us. We share the Great Lakes and thousands of miles of boundary waters with the Canadians. We have a 1909 Boundary Waters Treaty that was kind of reborn in 1972 with a specific focus on the Great Lakes Water Quality Agreement. And fortunately, that has formed a good basis for working with the Canadians collectively on protecting the Great Lakes. I don't know as much about the border with Mexico, but I am told that, particularly with the Colorado River, there is no Colorado River once it reaches Mexico. It's just all been consumed by the United States. I think there have been steps taken to share a little of that water, but interesting jurisdictional and legal issues associated with all of that. I'll also point out that there were some fortunate semi-accidental things that got us to finally take water quality a lot more seriously. And you hate to think it has to be this, because I think some smart scientists were telling us there were problems, but it was primarily the detergents and the foams, so you could see it on the water. And you all know that the Cuyahoga River in Cleveland caught fire. That's actually what got me into the business. I was in my dorm room in undergrad school, my senior year, and looking at my roommate's Time magazine, and I saw this picture of the Cuyahoga River on fire. And I said, you know, that really shouldn't be happening. I was majoring in English and was going to teach, but that didn't resonate with me much. I said, well, I'm going to go into environmental law. Didn't exist at the time, but I was kind of betting on the future with it. You know, fortunately, it did materialize. And the other thing, you know, Lake Erie died. And incidentally, it wasn't just the Cuyahoga River, the Buffalo River, the Detroit River, the Chicago River. They all caught on fire, too. There just didn't happen to be good pictures at the right time of that. But then Lake Erie died. And that, I think, was on the cover of Time magazine as well. So I taught these visual things as opposed to just look at the water and, you know, it looks okay, so it must be okay, before people started to take it seriously. So back to the Clean Water Act. And I've got to quote Professor Bullard here. And because it was, the Clean Water Act actually was a demonstration that technology forcing does work. And both the Clean Air Act and Clean Water Act had technology forcing elements. When both of them were passed, you know, industry just said, and cities as well, oh, we can't do this. This is impossible. You know, it will cost millions of jobs, and technically there isn't, you know, the ability to do it. Well, Congress, in its infinite wisdom, said, I'm sorry, but the pollution is too much. And under the Clean Water Act in particular, what it required by, it required, number one, everybody to have a permit, and number two, that by July 1 of 1977, to implement something called best practicable technology, still including an economic element in the analysis. And then by 1983, best available technology. And then it pushed it beyond that. If it were necessary to meet water quality standards, you got to do whatever it takes to meet that. And it was phenomenal to see how much technological development occurred as a result of the technology forcing elements. It actually put the water pollution control industry in this country in a world-leading position, much to the economic advantage of these companies. And I've always been a person, you know, I'm kind of green to the core, but if people make money, you know, on protecting the environment, that's okay with me. I don't mind that. It's all right. And renewable energy, air pollution, water pollution control, it's a good thing. I usually get a little carried away and hit the mic a few times. And the interesting thing is that the Clean Water Act contemplated zero discharge of pollution by 1985. I'm not sure we're going to make that, but it's always nice to have an aspirational goal out there. The other thing that was significant is there was teeth in the law, and that is basically would cost you $25,000 a day per violation if you violated the law. And fortunately, EPA had some institutional fortitude, and from the very beginning was, and not so much today, but has been a strong enforcement agency. And I've always, it was to me the first environmental justice and not to diminish what we think of as environmental justice now, but if companies go ahead and comply and you turn your head to those who are violating it, that is not just or equitable to the companies who do spend the money to comply. So enforcement was always a very major part of the work that I was engaged in. Just to give a tangible example, I worked on the 17 pulp and paper mill permits on the Wisconsin River, and these were all on my desk the first day I arrived. There was a pile of files and a pile of federal registers with regulations, and my orientation was, figure it out. And they said, no, figure it out. So, read the regulations and the guidance and looked at the applications, we started generating permits. Basically, they required about 85 to 95% reduction. And the focus was on traditional pollutants of biochemical oxygen demand and suspended solids and pH control and things like that. Didn't get to the toxics until later. But every one of the pulp and paper mill companies and cities challenged the requirements that had been imposed. So here I was, you know, fresh out of law school, and I did have hair, and it was a lot longer back then. And it kind of led, Pam didn't even know me then, but I've got pictures to prove it. But it drove the corporate attorneys nuts. You know, here's this kid just out of law school, and you know, looks like he's some wacko from New York or something. There I was, just a kid from Wisconsin. And so they all had 10, 20, 30 years of experience. And you know, I was, again, just green and fresh out of law school. But I said, no, this is what the law requires. This is what you have to do. So they challenged all of the permits and the guidance back and forth. And they're going to put us out of business. Everybody's going to lose their job, et cetera, et cetera. Well, at a certain point, and here comes the technology forcing side of things. When the lawyers started getting the background a little bit, and I was a lawyer, so. But I had two real good pulp and paper engineers, Jack Newman and Frank Hurley, both wonderful guys who had a lot of experience. They said, well, you can do this. And you got the engineers talking, and engineers. in University of Illinois, I know it's a fabulous engineering. They can get really excited about these projects. And then they'll say, I think we could do it. And the lawyers would say, no, don't say that, don't say that. Well, in any event, every one of these companies met or did better than was required of them. And they did it by July 1, '77 or before. The water quality improvements in the Wisconsin River were just dramatic in a very short period of time. In a river environment, the improvements come more rapidly because you're always getting a fresh flow of water. The fishery rebounded. The property values along the waterfront just exploded. And it was just a phenomenal turnaround. Now, unfortunately, this story, to my knowledge, has never really been told. And this was happening all over the country. And then push, push, push. But this, what this Clean Water Act did, and there was another round of improvements by 1983, and this clean water permit program, which now has been delegated to, I think, all 50 of the states, and they run the programs with federal oversight, is really the infrastructure and the foundation for clean water. Unfortunately, that wasn't enough. You know, that basically stopped the bleeding and slow down the deterioration of water. I want to talk briefly, and as usual, I get going on a lot of other things, and I don't finish as fast as I should, but nobody's fallen asleep or walked out yet. Maybe one or two fall asleep. But in any event, there were three major things that this didn't deal with effectively enough that we're still struggling with now. Number one is combined sewer overflows. Number two is something I will call legacy pollutants. And number three, I will call ongoing source pollution. These are the things that we are still struggling with. We've got to keep the infrastructure and permit program going to make sure. sure that we don't do any backsliding. But combined sewer overflows, most of the upper Midwest has combined sewers, which basically means the stormwater runoff and the sanitary waste from our homes all go to the same sewer system, and then they go to the wastewater treatment plant. And day in and day out, this is fine if it doesn't rain a whole heck of a lot. But what happens, and in particular because of population growth and paving over, making surfaces impermeable, the volume of water that goes into the systems has continued to increase. And with the intense precipitation events that we are experiencing as part of climate change, it is just getting worse and worse. And what happens is that there is more water going into the system than it has capacity to hold. And to prevent these pipes from just exploding or from everything to back up into our basements or up through toilets, and it does happen in the Chicago area even today, there are relief valves, if you will, combined sewer overflows, where this water that is a combination of stormwater and sanitary wastewater just goes off pipes directly to the river without receiving any treatment. This is a huge problem over the entire upper Midwest. Some communities have been able to actually separate their sewers. Grand Rapids, Michigan, Erie, Pennsylvania, Rochester, New York. Kind of medium size, 100 to 250,000, they've been able to go back. Now, what's resulted is a dramatic drop in combined sewer overflows. There is a little downside because the stormwater does pick up a fair amount of contamination just from the surface, but it's still a lot better than having all of the combined sewer overflows. Cities like Chicago, Milwaukee, and Cleveland have gone to things, in Chicago it's called a tunnel and reservoir system. It's been under construction for, I think, about 45 years now, for $2 to $3 billion. And the theory there is you've got the regular sewer system, the combined sewer system, but then there's a series of tunnels 200 feet below the surface of Chicago, and they're 20 feet in diameter, and they finally did actually get down, and they are 20 feet in diameter down there. And then there's a series of reservoirs, a couple of which have been opened, one major one, Cook, still needs to be opened, that will hold billions of gallons of water during the major rainfall events, that when the rain finally stops, it would come back through the treatment system. This has resulted in a dramatic decrease in the number of combined sewer overflows, although there still are some, and there are skeptics and critics of this whole approach. But it's a lot better than the first approach that Chicago took to dealing with its wastewater and sewers and things, and that was to reverse the flow of the Chicago River and send it down the state without asking anybody in St. Louis or anywhere down state. That's a whole separate story as well. It was a classic example of not solving the problem, but relocating the problem and creating additional problems. It probably saved many lives in the city of Chicago, and that is a good thing, of course. It really ruined the fishery in the Illinois River at the time, and you know, we still live with problems like Asian carp that have a pathway to the Great Lakes as a result of the connection of the river. So that's the combined sewer overflow problem. And again, this is another situation where climate change is making it a lot worse than it otherwise would be. Legacy pollution. Nobody really thought about, well, you know, these discharges have been going on for 100 years, and I guess we can't see them, so there must be no problem. Well, the river bottoms and harbor bottoms in particular, but out in lakes as well, have been accumulating contaminated material in many situations for over 100 years. The problem, in addition to that, is that there was no real legal structure to go back and hold people accountable for what was done in the past. It wasn't illegal what they did. And there really wasn't an awareness of this. So once we became aware of the contaminated sediments, and it really was the water quality agreement that identified 42 areas of concern in the U.S. and Canada around the Great Lakes, said, we got to start to deal with this problem. Well, for each one of these areas of concern, there was a citizen involvement process and development of something called remedial action plans. And a lot of people were involved, did a lot of work, and the problem was identified, and the cause of the problem was identified, and the solutions were identified. But then there was no money or anybody responsible to carry out the cleanup that was necessary, which is primarily dredging the old material out of the waters and disposing of it properly. It wasn't until early 2000s that we had something called the Great Lakes Legacy Act, which finally made some money available, and then started in 2010 something called the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative that the Trump administration has tried to kill, but thank goodness, in a bipartisan way, Congress has stepped forward to continue to make roughly $300 million a year available for cleanup activity like this. So there's been some great progress. And the Superfund law, which I won't get into, but it was another law that really hadn't contemplated going after these contaminated sediments, but some creative lawyers at the Environmental Protection Agency and other places decided to use it. I was heavily involved on the Fox River in Wisconsin, a 39-mile stretch of the river that was contaminated with polychlorinated biphenyls, PCBs, and it ultimately it's going to be about $1 billion project with 7 million cubic yards of contaminated sediment removed, and great progress is being made on that. So there has been some improvement in dealing with the legacy pollution. Non-point source pollution, and it's always a little risky to talk about that in farm country because a lot of non-point source pollution comes from agricultural operations. Some progress has been made, and is basically nutrients, phosphorus and nitrogen, that are the problem. And you know, it's not that you know farmers are bad people or doing bad things. It is just, I think it's the dynamics, the social dynamics, the cultural dynamics, the economic dynamics of it that have not allowed us to make more progress. The expanding dead zone in the Gulf of Mexico is largely due to us up here in Illinois, Iowa, Indiana, Missouri. And the largest single discharger of nitrogen to the Gulf of Mexico is the Metropolitan Water Reclamation District of Greater Chicago. And they're the largest single one. Obviously, there are many farms that go into it. So that is a real vexing problem. Lake Erie, algal blooms, and microcystin outbreaks and other cyanobacteria are a result of probably the biggest source is the Maumee River. There's a lot of work going on right now, and very fortunately, the governors of Michigan, Ohio, and the premier of Ontario have basically said, we've got to reduce the nutrient loadings by 40% by 2025. And actually, just setting that goal, there's a certain element of technology forcing and behavior change forcing that goes on with that I'm optimistic eternally that some progress is going to be made with this. So just one other little anecdote. One of the first matters I worked on, it was either my first or second year at EPA, I got a call from an inspector saying we got a problem with the farm down in Mount Vernon, Illinois. And He said he's having a big problem with pig mortality, and he's dumping them into a pond that go out into something called Eagle Creek and then Wren Lake, which is a water supply. And he said this is really a problem. And the Corps of Engineers, I think, manages Wren Lake, which I drove by for the first time on my way to Paducah, Kentucky, for the solar eclipse a few weeks ago. Fortunately, we got some good evidence, and the best evidence was pictures of dead pigs. And between the Monday when we found out about it, we were in front of a federal district court judge, I think it was in Pekin, Illinois, on Friday. Washington was saying, no, don't go after this, you know, the farm exemption and the Clean Water Act. Well, the judge said, I can't believe you're doing this to your neighbors. I want that cleaned up by Monday, or you are going to jail. And I don't think there was a legal basis for it, but the farmer got the idea, and he cleaned it up, and everything was okay by Monday. So there are some success stories out there. So to wrap up, and I've run, unfortunately, way over, but I hope this has been of some interest and value. As we often say, we've made a lot of progress, but we've got a long ways to go. And I would say, particularly under this administration, clearly protection of the environment, including water, is not a value or a priority. And it's going to take a lot of people, like the people in this room, at the voting booth in particular, but other places, to send a message of how important this is. I do think people are taking water less for granted. I was once asked, how do we get people to take it more seriously? And I said, well, it's pretty simple. This is why I would never run for elected office. Just turn it off for a while. It's like losing your power. Just turn off the water. The funny thing is, this was a Wednesday night, and on Friday they had to turn off the water in Toledo because of the microsystem contamination in Lake Erie. But I do think people are appreciating it a lot more. Some have predicted that this will be the century of water, the last century. I don't know, some say it was the century of oil. But time will tell about how serious we take it and how good of stewards we are. So thank you very much for your time and attention.
Try and be loud.
Okay,
I'd like to be first, but you talked about the 43 or 42 sites. I guess Waukegan Harbor is one of them.
Yes.
It's supposedly been remediated. Is it really? And I wanted to point out that my understanding is that that PCB waste was the problem that was being dumped on the Mahomet Aquifer. So there was a big struggle here to stop that from happening.
I do not believe that the PCB waste from, and the question was Waukegan Harbor just north of Chicago and whether or not the PCB waste had been taken to
Clinton landfill.
To my knowledge, that did not happen. This was one of the most seriously contaminated areas. There were samples of the sediments that were 500,000 parts per million PCB. That's halfway to being pure product. It just astounded me. The most concentrated part of that actually was put in a containment facility right at the plant itself, which I think there were a couple of concerns that there was some leakage. There's extensive monitoring. I think that has been dealt with. They dealt with the most serious part of the problem in the late 80s, early 90s, and then have been chipping away at the rest of it. I don't think they're 100% done yet, but they're pretty close to having removed all of that, and I think the disposal of it is very close to the facility itself. I doubt that any of that would have gone to this landfill that you described.
I think the lower level waste possibly were.
They
tried to do it as well.
Yeah, and the transportation costs would probably be too. Yes, in the back.
Would you comment on standing rock and the water projectors, their role, and given to this process of government, how do you see initiatives like that going forward?
I didn't catch the initiative.
Standing Rock.
Standing Rock.
Oh, Standing Rock.
Water protector.
Okay, I am not familiar with that, but any initiative is really, really important on this. And I don't know, and I wasn't aware of it, and I'm not aware of any of the details associated with it. But any initiative, number one, brings attention to water. Number two, highlights whatever problems there might be. And number three, and most importantly, pushes toward solutions of it, are critically important. And I'm becoming more and more convinced that what got the environmental movement going was broad-based citizen involvement. And what's going to, you know, deal with the situation we have now, again, is broad-based pushback. And I am convinced that, you know, fundamentally the people of this country want a clean environment. I think they understand that it is 100% compatible with economic development and viability. In fact, and this is another dangerous thing in Illinois, the future is not in coal. It is not. It has run its course like horses and buggies and stuff like that. The future is in renewables, and that is where the jobs will be, and you know that is where, you know, we're going to deal with the climate change as well. Yes, ma'am. Well, that's an excellent question, as all questions are. And I also usually make the confession I'm a recovering lawyer and I'm a recovering regulator, but there is a time and a place for regulators and lawyers. But balance, and I also say only half in jest, I really don't know a lot about many things, but I know a lot of smart people who do, like Mark Lewis, I think he left, and other people. But what I try to do is bring people of disparate interests together. And it's all about finding common ground. And it is not easy. In my heart, I always just wanted to be an environmentalist, but I couldn't get a job at it, and then it wound up being pretty good at EPA. And then with Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Cities Initiative, it was a kind of a hybrid government. We had no regulatory authority, but it was mayors, and but with an environmental interest. But I basically try to find that common ground. And what is always important is to be able to walk in other people's shoes. And as contentious as some of my battles were as a regulator, with the regulated community and industry, I was able to maintain a really good professional relationship with them. I basically always was right up front, let them know, you know, where I stood on something, and what was going to be required, what was negotiable, what was non-negotiable. I think just upfront honesty and, you know, fundamental treating of people with respect is really important. And sometimes it's hard. I remember dealing with a hazardous waste incinerator in East Liverpool, Ohio, and there was a particularly effective advocate, a woman by the name of Terry Swearinger. And it's really interesting, the number of women, particularly in the 80s, who were very effective environmental advocates. And the one thing that she did that kind of pushed me over the edge, and she didn't do it to me, she did it to one of our younger attorneys, and I think she sensed some vulnerability. She held a fork up in front of her face and put it in front of her and said, "I'm going to see you behind bars sometime." I never thought of this, but a little reminiscent of "Send her to jail," you know, that we heard in the debates last year. So I don't know. I think at the most fundamental level, it is how you treat people. And I think one of the most challenging problems has been the cultural difference in the agricultural community and what the regulated community is trying to do, and just a total lack of understanding of of the demands. And I've been working for the last 3 to 5 years on that one, and have made very little progress on it. So that's my attempt at an answer. Yes, ma'am.
So thank you for sharing.
I got to get closer.
Thank you for sharing the history that you shared and for kind of nicely summarizing the key places where a lot of work needs to be done. And it's clear that in your career, you were able to find kind of a nice fit between permission to go with the federal government, and it seems perhaps a little bit less optimistic that that's a good step people would be happy there currently now. And so for...
Very perceptive. Excellent question, and particularly appropriate here at the university. Number one, I will say that this too shall pass at the federal level. But for a lot of reasons, I think that there will be fewer opportunities in government than there were before. I was there in the golden age, and all we did was recruit people, interview people, hire people. Oops, I'm sorry. I wandered a little bit. I'll get back. Shame on me. But it was this constant growth between 1973 and 1990. There were a few aberrations in there. I think there still will be some opportunities in government, particularly as some of the old deadwood like me is gone, and that will open up some things. But my own feel, and there are some private sector opportunities as well. I think there are green companies that are trying to do the right thing. My own personal feeling is that the real future is in the non-government organization area and the philanthropic interests. Between Michael Bloomberg and Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, there is a lot of good being done in the world in a variety of different organizations. The Koch brothers do their own thing, but there are a lot of good things coming there. And from my own experience this last 14 years, and we were officially a non-government 501c3 charitable organization, but we had this quasi-government because I worked for 131 mayors, but there were only 3 of us in the organization, and I ran it alone for the first 3 years, and people asked me what I did, and I said, well, everything from clean the toilets to go to the White House for lunch, and it was true. But the flexibility that we have, just one example, I think you've all heard of the microbeads issue and problem from exfoliants and accumulating in the Great Lakes. Our mayors got very upset about it. He said, we want to do something about it. So what we did is, number one, and I knew this wasn't going to do any good, but I just wanted to do it, write Environment Canada and US EPA and say, this is a problem, what do you know, what are you going to do about it? Got incredibly bureaucratic letters back. Secondly, we encouraged all of our mayors to tell, we weren't going to do a boycott, but to tell their citizens about this to make informed consumer choices about things. But thirdly, I said, well, what the heck, let's just write the CEOs of the 10 companies that produce most of these products and consumer products. And they're concerned about their image, and they don't want to look bad. So we basically said, this is a problem in the Great Lakes. We think you're causing it. What are you going to do about it? And actually, six of the 10 came back and acknowledged, you know, the lawyers sanitized the letters, but they acknowledged there was a problem. Many of them had started to do something about it already, but many more started to do it, and I think they did it faster because we basically, we got a lot of publicity on these letters. We put them on the spot. Congress eventually passed a law last year that bans the microbeads and the new products that are being phased out. But that's just a very small example of how a nimble, small non-government organization can do things. And I think there will be many, many opportunities like that. I guarantee you will not get rich working for them, but if your interest in life is to make the world a better place to live, that's a good thing to do. Yes, sir.
I wonder if you could just say a little bit about the economics of some of the protections. You talked about the effluents from the paper mill, and obviously if they've got a pipe to shove the stuff in the river, that costs a lot less than putting some kind of control to clean it up first. So how much did we pay more at the marketplace for our toilet paper and bond paper?
I couldn't give you a precise figure, but and I'm not an economist, but I hope you're not an economics professor. But one of the early things that I read a little bit about was externalizing costs. And basically, what had been done was by not treating it and spending the money on pollution control, they were externalizing the cost by depressing the land values of the people along the river, depressing the retail value of sport fishing shops and things like that. I don't know how much more we pay for individual products for companies to be doing the right thing about it, but I think we should pay for it. I would rather pay more for my toilet paper than I'll use a little bit less of it, but rather than having that cost imposed, a cost imposed upon the broader community. And that, that's kind of a fundamental dynamic here of internalizing the externalized cost. The other thing, and just to throw a number out there, the Great Lakes Fishery is estimated to have a value of $7 billion a year, just on the U.S. side. If Asian carp get into the Great Lakes and negatively affect that, there are going to be a lot of people who are going to be a lot less well off because of that. Now, the barge industry is pushing real hard not to have an aggressive system to keep the Asian carp from getting into the Great Lakes. So, there are just a lot of things going on there. The other thing I think is that whatever we may pay for more in terms of individual products, the kind of jobs that are created and value that is created in the pollution control industry way outstrip the number of jobs lost and things like that. So the economics work. I'm not an economist, but the economics work. I did want to say one other thing that I forgot. While driving down, just coming out of Chicago, on the west side of I-57, there is a big sign up there that says, "The truth does not matter. It's only ideas that will prevail." And I didn't have time to catch the fine print of who put that up there. But it's very frightening because whether it's the truth of climate change or the truth of racial discrimination, or the truth of the economics of pollution control, if that is not highlighted, we're in serious duty. Well, I think I've worn you all out. I could go on forever. I love this stuff. I'm a distance runner, and all my life I've said, my That's the best training I've had, the ability to endure pain over a long period of time. And this is not painful, but the ability just to keep going is very important. So I plan to keep running forever and keep fighting for what I think is the right thing. And, nothing else, and it'll all last a while. So thank you very much.
You know, I was on disability for a while. I retired early from the French Club. A lot of time on my hands.
Yeah, whatever you call that, retirement.
What I do, but I fill up my time pretty well.
I tell people there's no such thing as retired.
The judge did.